Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this YouTube channel this week. As announced last Sunday, two of my churches, Backcountry Heath and Goodmayes, begin their Sunday morning worship back in their church premises from today, and Gans Hill from next Sunday. And as announced, those services for the next four Sundays will be live streamed. Backcountry Heath at 10 o'clock, Goodmayes at 11:30, and Gans Hill from next Sunday, 11:30 as well. And so please join us and give us some comments, because we will be exploring this live streaming for the next four Sundays. And the question then, what does happen to this YouTube channel, which I've been and we've been worshiping together for the last 6 months? And the plan that I have got in my mind for the next four Sundays is, alongside our live streamed services from three of my churches, I'd like to offer an opportunity to read the given Bible passage, quite likely the passage that I will want to preach, and offer my reflection here, which hopefully will feed into your reading and reflection on that particular passage. And please also use the comments section so that you will be able to leave comments and we can keep our communication that way. And that's the plan, and we will see how it goes. And this is the first Sunday. And I'd like to suggest that we begin with a hymn which will be used this morning in our churches. All Things Bright and Beautiful. The Bible passage which I've chosen for this morning is the Old Testament lectionary reading, Exodus chapter 16, verses 2 to 15. I'm going to read it from the Good News Bible. There in the desert, they all complained to Moses and Aaron and said to them, "We wish that the Lord had killed us in Egypt. There we could at least sit down and eat meat and as much other food as we wanted. But you have brought us out into this desert to starve us all to death." The Lord said to Moses, "Now I'm going to make food rain down from the sky for all of you. The people must go out every day and gather enough for that day. In this way, I can test them to find out if they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day, they are to bring in twice as much as usual and prepare it. So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "This evening you will know that it was the Lord who brought you out of Egypt. In the morning you will see the dazzling light of the Lord's presence. He has heard your complaints against him. Yes, against him, because we are only carrying out his instructions." Then Moses said, "It is the Lord who will give you meat to eat in the evening and as much bread as you want in the morning. Because he has heard how much you have complained against him. When you complain against us, you are really complaining against the Lord." Moses said to Aaron, "Tell the whole community to come and stand before the Lord, because he has heard their complaints." As Aaron spoke to the whole community, they turned towards the desert, and suddenly the dazzling light of the Lord appeared in a cloud. The Lord said to Moses, "I have heard the complaints of the Israelites. Tell them that at twilight they will have meat to eat, and in the morning they will have all the bread they want. Then they will know that I, the Lord, am their God." In the evening, a large flock of quails flew in, enough to cover the camp. And in the morning, there was dew all round the camp. When the dew evaporated, there was something thin and flaky on the surface of the desert. It was as delicate as frost. When the Israelites saw it, they didn't know what it was and asked each other, "What is it?" Moses said to them, "This is the food that the Lord has given you to eat." So this morning, we're going to spend some time on this passage from Exodus. The Exodus is the story of God who saves Israel from slavery, of God who leads them to the promised land. And I think this is by far the most important and also exciting part in the history of Israel. But actually, when we read this book chapter by chapter and line by line, that's not the impression we get. It is also a story of a very unhappy and grumpy people who struggle to make sense of a life in the wilderness. See how our passage for today begins. There in the desert, they all complained to Moses and Aaron and said to them, "We wish that the Lord had killed us in Egypt." Well, they are not happy, are they? They are very depressed, aren't they? Where are they at this moment? Let's just ask. Verse 1 of this chapter tells us that it's been a month and a half since they left Egypt and they have run out of food. So they begin to make complaint. Do you know how many times the word complain is used in our passage this morning? 7 times. That's a lot for this short passage, isn't it? The more I think about how they must have felt, however, living in this wilderness, this unbound, uncharted, and a very unfamiliar place, the less I want to blame for their complaint. And perhaps we, living through this time of the pandemic and the time of great uncertainty in our own generation, we are in a better place to understand their frustration and their complaint, and even their nostalgia for the better time in the past. The Israelites have gone from the life that was structured and familiar, although cruelly, by their slave masters, to a life that hasn't got much shape yet. And to them, God offers a new way of life, which eventually will give them an identity as a community of faith. And this morning I'd like to offer some thoughts on a couple of things and a couple of details in our passage today. apart from this constant reminder of how grumpy and depressed that these people of Israel were, we also hear what God then offered to them. Verse 12, I have heard the complaints of the Israelites. Tell them that at twilight they will have meat to eat, and in the morning they will have all the bread they want. And then they will know that I, the Lord, am their God. So God's own device in resolving this food shortage and teaching them a way to become a new community of faith was the manna and quail, which needed to be harvested every day. So how then do they respond first to this plan? They just don't know what to make of it. Verse 15, when the Israelites saw it, they didn't know what it was and asked each other, what is it? They hadn't seen anything like it. It wasn't like a pizza or pasta or fish and chips or Sunday roast or sausage and mash, or it wasn't like sushi or jollof rice or chicken tikka masala. They hadn't seen or tasted anything like it before. So they kept asking each other, what is it? What is it? What is it? And decided to call it, what is it? And that's the meaning of the word manna in Egyptian. They couldn't tell what it was, but they knew that it was from God, as Moses told them, this is the food that the Lord has given you to eat. And another detail which I'd like to draw your attention to is actually a couple of verses straight after our passage today, verses 16 to 18. And let me read it to you. The Lord has commanded that each of you is to gather as much of it as he needs, 2 liters for each member of his household. The Israelites did this, some gathering more, others less. When they measured it, those who gathered much did not have too much, and those who gathered less did not have too little. Each had gathered just what he needed. And I think we hear the message of God in this unfamiliar food of manna and the meaning of this daily harvest for them and also for our harvest as we celebrate it this year. Everyone in their community, those who were able, would go out day and night to gather the manna and quail. And obviously, some would gather more and some others less. But when they brought all their harvest back home and shared with others, they discovered every day that each of them had gathered just what they needed for all. And we know that they were in the wilderness for 40 years. Imagine experiencing this same miracle of God knowing and feeding everyone in their community in this way for 40 years. Some gathered more and others less, and the others who weren't able, nothing at all. But every day they had exactly what they needed. And what an amazing way to learn about God and the kind of a community that God desired for them. No wonder why this time of their history played a dominant part in shaping their law, their identity, and their way of life. God repeated the same lesson for 40 years by feeding them and exactly knowing how much they would need every day. And I find this story resonating powerfully to our experience today. This year, the year 2020, has been exceptional in so many ways, hasn't it? Life since March feels like has been all consumed by the abrupt halt on so many of our daily and weekly activities in all those places where our life exists, whether it is our home or workplace or our church. And despite all our efforts to keep our lives safe from this virus and support those in need, we've lost so many lives. Still thousands of people get infected every day. And many in our community have lost their job. Nearly 700,000 people in Britain alone have lost their job and came off from payroll since March. And I don't have to go on any further to give you more examples of how quickly the landscape of life has changed, as if overnight we found ourselves in the wilderness, in this uncharted and unfamiliar place. And we may also want to complain this morning, saying, what's the point of gathering for worship in our church again while we only have half an hour for the service, with no singing, no fellowship before and after? Aren't we better off staying home? Well, we may ask today. And I need to tell you that we're going to celebrate harvest this year in our churches this morning. While preparing for the reopening of our church premises for worship and community, the phrase I've often used myself and heard others using it has been, it will be a learning curve. Yes, it is true that we have learned a lot. All these measures that we need to place to make our church a safe place to come back. And we will want to follow from this week in our churches. And we'll continue to learn new ways as the situation evolves. But let me take this question to another level. We say this has been a learning curve, but what have we learned from this time of the pandemic about God and about us as a community of faith? And that's what this story of the Exodus is all about, the story of what the people of Israel have learned despite all their discomfort, disbelief, and lots of complaints. Can our experience today also has the meaning to define and redefine who we are as the people of God and who God is to us? What's the strange food that God provides to sustain our life today? And that's the question I'd like to leave you with as we reflect on this passage this morning, and as we begin to worship again back in our church premises. And this morning in two of my churches, we're going to celebrate the harvest of the year. And thinking about it, perhaps this is the strangest year to celebrate harvest. Not that the earth has stopped producing any harvest, it has, but because we and our human life has seen so many restrictions and limitations. So many aspects of our life have become dependent upon the works of others, those who work to provide food, healthcare, public services, and all the basic necessities of life. Aren't they the manna and quail which have been faithfully harvested even during this time of the pandemic? And what we still have, our time, energy, and money, are also the manna and quail which God plans to use to make sure all is fed and nurtured in our community. After all, the message of harvest is not that we have worked hard and deserve a celebration, but the message hidden in this manna that God provides. That the manna that God gives is more than just food. It is comfort, blessings, identity, relationships, charity, and the harvest of hope for all his children. And that is the testimony of all God's children, the testimony of the people of Israel, and the testimony of our lives today, that God provides. God has provided throughout our time in this pandemic, and God will continue to provide. God help us. Amen. And we're going to close our time of reflection with a hymn that we often sing at our harvest festivals. We plow the fields and scatter. Thank you for joining me. I hope you have enjoyed this time together and it has been helpful in your reflection on this passage. And please feel free to use the comment section below. And have a good week. And until next time, God bless.